And as you will see the title, it says Designing Innovation Value Chains for Societal Impact. So every word, there is a meaning. The first word is designing. Second is innovation value chain. So innovation is not a single process. It's a value chain. And we will see what is the value chain. And the question is that when we do all these and get our innovations through, we want to implement. And then we want to quickly assess what is the societal impact of these innovations that we are talking about. So it's most appropriate that we recall in the very first page of the brochure of the Atal Community Innovation Center is the statement of late Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee. And if you remember, of an India that is prosperous, strong and caring, an India that regains a place of honor in the committee of great nations. Now, we need to look at this title in the context of what late Atal Bihari Vajpayee said. That is number one. Number two is when we look at the Atal Community Innovation Center, again, your brochure says deploy, transform. So I think if you put all this together, the title of today's presentation sort of takes in what Atal Bihari Vajpayee had said and what is the spirit with which the Atal Community Innovation Center has been set up. Keeping this in mind, the way I want to proceed is if I go to the next slide, then in the next slide, which Unnat is supposed to, yes, I'm going to take some case studies. All the case studies all of us are very familiar with Amul. It's one of the greatest innovations that the world has seen. Then we will come to an innovation called Taraltech, from a company called Taraltech. And interestingly enough, the inventor and the interpreter has also joined us, Mr. Anjan Mukherjee, has also joined us for this particular session. Then I have a third one called Prashak. So again, the entrepreneur and the innovator of this particular startup has also joined us in today's session. Then I'm going to take in an example from Vishwakarma University Pune, and our colleagues from Vishwakarma University Pune have also joined the session. And last, I will take a very interesting example from PepsiCo, where it is a very, very interesting innovation, which has had very strong impact on community. It's very interesting that all these innovations are in India. And two, at least we have three of the five examples that I'm going to quote are actually a part of this session today. So each of these case studies, one by one, we will run through the case studies. And then after that, I will go into the theoretical background as to what are the key learnings and how should we look at or look forward to the year, you know, in the years ahead, that when we innovate, when we do things, how we should really proceed. So that will be the structure. So if you people have any questions at any stage, do raise it and we will see how and when to answer and respond to this. Okay, so that's the structure of today's session. Let us go to the first case study, which is very well known. That is the case of Amul. And it is something very interesting. It has in it all the ingredients of designing innovations. So we go to the case study number one, Amul, which is one of the fine examples of innovative social movement. It's a very innovative social movement and then it put together into it very inclusive innovations, having technology, logistics, whole bunch of things together, and everything for a social good. And all of us are familiar with what is going on. Now, if I go to the very first slide of the first case study, so the next slide, if I take on, let's go to the next slide. Now here, very important. So we must first see what is the problem addressed and the approach is taken. Why? If you want to design innovation value chains, then I must know what problem I'm tackling. How will I design an innovation value chain? The first part, very, very interesting. As far as Amul is concerned, 1946, and I don't know how many of you were born. I was just about born in 1948. So, and I remember those days, we used to have Paulson Butter. So Paulson was a British company, and it was doing milk processing and operating in the Kerala village and had complete monopoly on milk processing and distribution. And the local marginal farmers could only sell milk to Paulson. They couldn't sell to anybody else at prices that were not under their control, which was completely under the British rule. This was completely a competitive process that if the farmers got them, you know, produce the milk, then only people whom they can only sell to Paulson. So what did they do? Very interesting. The first innovation that took place for no other than the inspirational leadership of Sardar Vallabhbhai Patel. And what was that inspirational leadership? Together with, you know, the other, Tribhuvanas Patel, the farmers wanted to really revolt. So what did they do? As a retort to Paulson, they formed their first, what they called as the Kerala District Cooperative Milk Producers Union Limited in Anand, so that they could enable milk collection from marginal farmers, put them all together, and that will not necessarily give it to Paulson, but what they want. That was a great innovation in how to make, put people together and create strength from it. They create collective strength through that. Then came in a very interesting part, the second innovation. 1948, milk pasteurization opened new opportunities as shelf life of milk could be increased. And therefore more cooperatives joined this particular movement under a common name Amul. And they then became a local brand. So you can see how communities came together to really establish this sort of a strength. And a very interesting thing came about is that all these merged together under a large cooperative, namely Gujarat Cooperative Milk Marketing Federation Limited, the brand Amul was adopted by them. This gave birth to a completely. Please understand, when we talk about innovations, it's not only about science and technology, it is about everything. Any change that we bring in is an innovation. Every idea that we have is an innovation. So, how they transformed the entire processes, you know, in the community and bringing the community together. Let's go to the next slide. As we go to the next slide, we take further to the next slide. Yes. Now, in this slide again, what do you see?
Sir, sorry to disturb you. We are experiencing some difficulty in hearing you. Would request while you are presenting, you can also turn off your video so that your full bandwidth is available for audio transmission.
What should I do?
Just turn off your video.
Turn off the video. Okay. I've turned off the video. Yeah. Is it better?
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Good. I've turned off the video. So now we go to the next, to this one. Amul's innovation continually touched what? You know, how do you do quality monitoring because you're collecting milk from various people? How do you do the outreach to the farmers? And very important technology development. what happened during that time? Please understand that in Europe, they would deal with cow's milk. Buffalo is something very typical of India. So whatever technology is there for cow's milk cannot directly be applied to buffalo. And therefore, the interesting part, the first breakthrough that was done under this cooperative was development of skimmed milk and milk powder from buffalo milk. It's amazing that when Nestle and others were working on cow's milk in India, because our cows have very low productivity, they, you know, and we use buffalo milk. So the whole thought process, you can see, is transformational. They went into from cow's milk to buffalo's milk, and they made a technology out of buffalo's milk to produce skim milk and milk powder. Tremendous breakthrough. And after that, they followed into development of cheese and other products based on buffalo milk. It's absolutely a phenomenal innovation. You can see that how you can get into transformational features. And then, of course, all of us know Varghese Kurian, his concept, vision, planning, and execution. They called him the milkman of the world. So you can see how they went into product diversification. First of all, how they collected the milk, how they created the cooperatives, how they created all those other parts. So that was the innovation. They created the base first, okay? They had in mind that they were going to not only have technology, but technology will come later. And that's how it came in. Look at the idea. The first part of idea, that how do you use buffalo milk? We have so much of buffalo milk, how do we do it? Now, then subsequently, they went into product diversification to meet different, you know, market requirements. And that is how, with a lot of creative advertisements and putting things together, how Amul went into the market and established itself as a power brand, as we all know. Let's go to the next slide. And therefore, if you look at this slide, you know, there are lots of things, but I just want to pick up a few things, that how in different in the villages and in local areas, how the farmers started interacting, and how once you start and get the advantage of scale, then look at the left side of the slide, veterinary services, animal husbandry, animal feed factory, milk and producers, agricultural university, rural management institute, you know, trucking facilities, whole bunch of things in the value chain. Great idea. But the vision that you will need to really look at these things at great detail and length, you can see how all the ancillary industries open up and creates opportunities for a whole range of things within the community. This is the power behind looking at value chains. And this is the value chain that I'm talking about. So what Kurian had in mind at that stage, not end with only collecting milk, not only make a cooperative, but then how do you exploit the whole thing in the marketplace? And therefore, you need to look at the entire value chain. And this is the value chain that we are talking about, as far as they are concerned. Go to the next slide. So what is the social impact? I don't need to elaborate. You know, more than 100 million dairy farmers are in the network. Tremendous. Rural employment opportunities, enhancement of rural economy, improvement in the quality of livestock, extensive crossbreeding. You can see a whole bunch of things, social empowerment, pride, confidence, you know, impact on national laws. In fact, national laws changed because of Amul, the, you know, laws on cooperatives, laws on taxation, laws on food, various type of things. All those things changed. And therefore, you can see that one great idea, one great vision, but seeing it through up to the end is a great part. And you need to look at all these things together. So the calculate, they, you know, it is incalculable benefits. So when you look at all this, Amul is a classic example, according to me, which this country has given to the world. And therefore, this is absolutely correct when Atul Bihari Vajpayee looked at the whole thing, that yes, can India have a pride position anywhere in the world. Amul is a fantastic example of that. So with this, I now go to the second case study. So we go to the next slide, which is second case study. Mr. Anjan Mukherjee has joined us today. Welcome to Anjan. And, you know, it's a very interesting case. This is, you know, Anjan actually has been, you know, he used to do engineering, study engineering in IIT Bombay. And then he, for a substantial part of his life, he was in Merchant Navy. He was in, you know, shipping. So he was in that, used to do his own studies and whatnot and give a lot of ideas. And he came up with an idea. And the idea is that how can we design to give safe water, which is possibly microbe-free from tube wells? So how do we do that? And you can see that on one side of this particular slide is a tube well and they're installing Anjan's device. And on the left side, there is that device which is being put inside the tube well, so fitting in. So I just thought these two photographs would just sort of illustrate what we are talking. Let's go to the next slide, where we go into some more details of Anjan's invention. What is the invention? Very interesting. All of us know that when, say, water flows, when water or any fluid flows, and you bring some sort of a net in front of it or any obstruction, and the flowing water hits it, what does it do? It creates bubbles. Water bubbles, nothing else, but there is a water film and there is air inside. These are called cavities. And what happens is that the flowing water as it goes, it creates these bubbles. Now, when the bubbles burst, all of us have seen the bubbles burst, what happened? The energy comes out. It gives rise to heat, it gives rise to pressure, it gives rise to turbulence in the fluid or in the water. The interesting part is you can design the type of obstructions in front of the flowing liquid, and that's the invention. The invention is how do you design the right type of obstructions in front of the flowing water so that you get bubbles of the right size, of the right dimensions, and so that when those bubbles burst, it will release energy from those bubbles. So what happens when you make these bubbles in very, very small, in and all in microns, you can do that. And when you do these, it releases huge amount of energy, it releases huge amount of heat, pressure, and creates turbulence in the fluid. And therefore, what happens if there are microbes in the vicinity of these particular bubbles, this energy and the heat goes and kills the microbes. You don't need electricity, you don't need anything. So the device you see out there is a very simple device, has this type of a concept in it. And so when you put, you know, when you let the water flow through it, that is what it does. It simply kills the microbes, you know, which are in the water, simply by the flowing water and with this particular device. There is no electricity. There are no chemicals, there is no UV, there are no membranes, you don't need to boil it, nothing you need to do. And this particular device, which Anjan had designed, is something which is very unique in the world. If you go to the next slide, you will see what does this do. Very interesting that when you do this particular, when you create this thing, then immediately you look at what are the various options. So the first part is you have developed this technology, you have made the device, you have set up manufacturing units to make this particular device. So as a technology developer and a, you know, and making it and doing a scale up and doing all these things as a startup, he's also registered as Startup India. So as a startup, what you have to do, you have developed, you've done everything, but you have a limited capacity. So the question is, can you then link up with other parties who can probably take this further, you know, and go to very high volumes and create a business out of these? So technology developer who in the Anjan, you know, is in the process now of striking business deals with various parties of various types who will either manufacture or incorporate them in the tube wells and create a big business where he becomes a partner. So very important part, that all these innovations that are done before you go public, you must protect it with the appropriate intellectual property rights. And therefore, what did Anjan do? He filed patents for this innovation in India and in several countries, which are at the moment being prosecuted. He has filed trademark of his Taraltech, which is the name, with the logo and all that. And all the brochures and everything that he has done, those are all copyrighted. So he has trademark, he has patent, copyright. So he protects them with his intellectual property rights out there. And very important, I can say that it's, as our Mr. Anjan Mukherjee can say, that, it gives completely micro-free. An important part in the innovation process is performance tested and validated by independent Indian and international agencies. And of course, he's the winner of several awards, national and international. I won't go into elaboration. But the important part now is, how does he go to the market? And therefore, he's worked out a full, what is meant by partners? Partner means two things. Partner, somebody has asked a question, so partner means two things. One is you can collaborate with somebody and create a contract between you and the collaborator and make the relationship between you. So the collaborator becomes a partner. You can also, for example, have a partner where you can have a partnership. That could be a partnership. You can be developing, so you can also license your patent, and somebody that you may be manufacturing, you may be marketing, or you may give it to somebody to manufacture it, and you may be marketing. So it, all sorts of possibilities are there. Similarly, there could be partners abroad who will be probably making it there and marketing it there with license from Anjan. So that's why the intellectual property rights are very important at that stage. So how do you license? How do you allow others to do and yet to gain something out of this particular process? So I hope I have explained the meaning of the word partner. Now we come to case study three. This is another very interesting one. And again, the entrepreneur, Dr. Praful Naik, has joined us in today's meeting. So, it's a very rare situation that when you're making presentation, you have the actual innovators, you have the entrepreneurs who have joined us in this particular session. So these are not just case studies out of nowhere. These are real case studies that we are talking about. And what is this case study about? As you will see, it says Habitat Nirvana Tantra, Innovating Housing and Sanitation Technology Solutions. And you can see that Prashak is the name of the organization. So again, let us start with what is the problem being addressed. It says they look at it holistically. What is it? Greener, disaster resilient, energy efficient, sustainable and affordable on-site sanitation, integrated social housing clusters. You can see there are a lot of complex words out there. What does this mean? It means that we are talking about situations where you can see that diagram which is put there, using simple techniques and technologies, using local resources, using green and sustainable processes, disaster resilient. Suppose there is an earthquake or storm, that it should resist that particular bit. Long-term durability, you're going to invest and you want to make it cost effective. So doing all this is very interesting. And they call it, that is when you look at their entire process, this is what they're looking at. So to do this, two things are very important. First part, which is very important, is that they're talking about how to make this housing. That means they're talking about making different types of, say, instead of using bricks, the standard bricks, instead of using the standard type of structural things which are conventional. They went into a completely different technology. They developed, as I will show you, they developed different types of blocks that are compacted and, you know, environmentally cured. Then they can vertically reinforce them on the foundation walls. So these are completely new concepts in construction of structures, right? So instead of, you know, plastering, so they got rid of plastering. The way they have created these particular blocks, they don't need plastering. So very important. Then while designing these blocks, they have to say, you know, this must have seismic strengthening for structural thing. And very important, after you have made these houses or housing out there, you know, sanitation is a very important part. We have less of water. Okay? We don't want to use too much of energy. So how do you have a closed loop on-site sanitation system to include these sort of things? So you can see that the problem that they're looking at is big, it's a massive problem. They're looking at a situation, they're looking for holistic solutions. Therefore, the standard type of conventional approaches will not work. So they need to look at completely new. And therefore, what I've given here is reinforced load-bearing dwellings for ground plus two levels are created without beams and columns, having long-term durability with minimal or no maintenance cost. Very important. So you can see that it's loaded with concepts. And this needs a very sound understanding of materials, of construction, you know, how to do construction, building, whole bunch of things, including the concepts of sanitation and whatnot. So now we go to the next slide, having understood the, you know, huge problem. So now what did they do? For this research and development, again, partnership is the word I'm using. So, you know, at the Asian Institute of Technology in Thailand, where even I used to go once upon a time, now there, they were developing many of these things. And Professor Siddharth Jabde, who is also attending the session, and Praful Naik were also there. Now, there in Asian Institute of Technology, they're developing these things. Now, somebody like Mr. Praful Naik, Dr. Praful Naik, saw the opportunity and immediately said, that's the technology I'm looking for. And immediately jumped at it. And what did he do? He has been a co-inventor with other inventors from AIT and with Siddharth Jabde, Indes. And immediately, what did they do? Because they saw the huge potential in this technology that they can really go and do it, they immediately got into some sort of a deal with the Asian Institute of Technology. They said, look, we will become joint inventors, number one. Number two, Asian Institute of Technology can be the owner of the patents, but they will give an exclusive license to Dr. Praful Naik and his organization, Prashak, out there, and Prashak will manage the whole intellectual property rights. So you can see the first part is that when you see a very lucrative technology, what you have done is that you have immediately jumped at it and you have created a partnership. And this is a fair partnership where, because you're seeing a massive business opportunity, you say, fine, you remain the owner, I have no problems, but give me an exclusive license so nobody else anywhere in the world should be able to use these intellectual property rights except Dr. Praful Naik. Very important. Let's go to the next slide. Now, so what I've done here is I've taken bits and pieces of what they have done. You can see those blocks on the left side, and then how they put those out and how, without making beams, straight from bottom to the top, they can go straight away. Very different type of construction out there. And therefore, you can see what is written there is intermeshing blocks, self-align, making construction process simple. It eliminates use of mortar in between block layers, giving high, smooth, and uniform finish, and obvious plastering. You can see the savings and cost. Just because you have created these intermeshed blocks, a huge amount of cost simply goes away out there. So you can see this innovative thinking. And therefore, if you see what is written on the right side, dwellings at affordable cost ensures safety, you know, mitigates risk of health and well-being of residents, local employment. Why? Because you can easily train local people to use these particular blocks to put them. You're not putting mortar, you're not putting plastering, and these are self-aligning blocks. So very easy. It's like, you know, like that Lego sets. So they are creating Lego sets, Lego-like sets, that you can put them all together. And therefore, this is one part. Very important part is that it enables viability of financial inclusion model and participation come empowerment, I mean, pride of the local community. So you bring in the local community together into this whole process. So there is a lot of cultural linkage, there is a lot of training, there's a lot of other things that go with this. And this is the type of building one is talking about. And with these type of simple building blocks, it is out there. Okay. So where low skill is required to put in, you know, it does not require a huge amount of picking up things and taking somewhere. So all this is something very innovative. So important part is the thinking, how you design these innovations, the entire value chain, keeping in mind where you will do it, how you will do it, and what does what. Let's go to the next slide. Very interesting one is that here we have looked at the building. Now we are looking at this closed loop sanitation management. So you can see the toilet that they have made up there and a new technology that they have where they will use the soil, the natural property of the soil to let the things go down. And the whole thing is designed in such a way that you can put these all together and you can see it will create safe and it gives you an affordable, sustainable, easily manageable solution that ensures safety, health, and well-being of the community. So you can see that how closed loop sanitation management is also designed. So when you look at the whole building process that you talk about, but don't end only with the box. You use the technology and go far ahead and creating this holistically and inclusively and see what sort of training will be required. Will you need migrant labor? No. You can use the local people, train them up. It'll give jobs, it'll do all sorts of things out there. So this is where the innovation of this type comes about. Let's go to the next slide. So again, look at this part, very interesting. Please read the first thing and on the right side, see the photograph. The president, the former president, you know, Honorable Shri Pranab Mukherjee, and the Secretariat of the President of India adopted this program concept model conceptualized by Prashant. Only licensed this trademark to Smart Ground to launch this initiative out there. And he adopted 100 villages in Haryana for transforming them into smart, sustainable villages. Not only that, you can see Praful Naik explaining to the president what the then president, the entire thing out there. That's the photograph of Praful Naik explaining out there. Now the interesting part is that in Rashtrapati Bhavan itself, that they have actually implemented this whole thing in Rashtrapati Bhavan in Delhi as well, apart from other places in Haryana. Now, who are the other partners? Then the Central Building Research Institutes of CSIR is a partner for R&D. Indian Society of Agribusiness Professionals, you know, they have made it giving. Now, what happened in CBRI later, I'm not too sure. That maybe we'll ask Prabhu to answer that. Prabhu, can you answer? Prabhu, are you there? Okay.
I'm here, Dr. Kholi.
Yeah, Prabhu, if you're there, can you answer this question as to.
CBRI has given a mandate that they would be a front-end endorsing agency for any government or any international project which will happen. They would so there are two perspectives of CBRI involvement. One is if there is any continued improvement to be done to make the structure from, say, G+2 to G+4, whether they would work jointly with Prashak. And the second is, of course, for any project where there is a need for a independent endorsing agency like CBRI. They would be the one who would endorse the project and would certify the disaster resilience and the life of the structure. So either way, these two aspects are still active, and they are working. We are working together in terms of putting it across to various governments, including some initiatives outside of India also.
Now, another question that came about has been asked just now is whether they charge you for that. What is the arrangement with CBRI?
We have a royalty arrangement that all projects where CBRI will be involved, there will be a portion of royalty. The agreement which has been signed between CBRI and project correlates to having a small portion of the total outcome as a.
So very important. So now it's very important that you can see that during the project tenure itself, it is not that it is being done after the project is over. These are all things happening during the project. And therefore, we have to think about all these relationships, and each relationship will be different from the other relationship. Why? Because the purpose of the relationship will be different. And therefore, the way you will sign the MOUs, the way you will sign the confidentiality agreements, the way you will sign the benefit sharing arrangements, the way it will be a contract, all these will be different. So these are very important areas to think about. So therefore, when we talk about designing of innovation value chains, we have to keep all these in mind together. We cannot think about them later. We have to think them, to co-think, if I may use the word calling co-think. Okay. So you have to think about in different parts of your brain to think about all these things at the same time and put them in the jigsaw puzzle and use it as and when. Similarly, you can see ONGC, you can see MOU with Government of India Enterprise for telecommunication, so you're looking, when you're looking at a project like this, what I want to emphasize, it does not come only with the making of the blocks or only making of a building. It is looking at the whole thing holistically, and not only thing, looking at it holistically, the entire last mile. Otherwise, what happens? It goes to the last mile and it gets knocked out. Very important. Let's go to the next slide. So we go to case study 4. So this is an interesting case study where Willow is a company and Vishwakarma University is in Pune. And they are working. So now it is a different case with an industry university collaboration. We all talk about industry university collaboration. There are very few good examples. Here is a very good working example. And I am in the board of governors of Vishwakarma University, Pune. I mean, I have been with the university right from the very day one when the university was conceptualized. So what we have done there is this, all these concepts of designing innovation, taking it through the entire process, is something that we have made it. Okay. So now in this, now I'm just giving one example of the many things that are happening there. But the one example which I've done is development of a vertical sewage treatment plant. So we go to the next slide. And just for people who are not familiar with sewage treatment plants, I won't go into the technology, but interesting, very simple, that most sewage treatment plants are horizontal. When it's horizontal, it requires a lot of land, and therefore land becomes a limitation. Now the space becomes a limitation. Now, if you want to design these type of sewage treatment plants in housing clusters or housing societies, you don't have much land. So the question is, the conventional ones, sewage plants, are horizontal. Now the question is, can you make them vertical? If you make it vertical, then it will require less space, right? Substantially reducing the footprint. Footprint means the space, the out there. So can you make it vertical? Right? Then you can add, but the important part, moment you make it vertical, what are the technology issues? technology issues, that there will be a pressure drop, you will have to pump things up, you have to do various things, the entire technology will change. So this company, Willo, you know, they are masters of water treatment, waste treatment. So they joined hands with the, you know, water quality center of excellence that is in our Vishwakarma University. So for cross-functional and industry interface innovation. So this is very important, that already before you even conceptualize, you have an industry partner who says, look, if you get something, I will commercialize it. So what happens now? See, very important that in the university, we want to use this also as a training of students and faculty. So the techno-commercial viability and potential markets are done by the commerce and management students and faculty in the university. The technical aspects were researched by the are being researched by engineering students and faculty. Some of the faculty and others have also joined us today in this particular session. Then industry participation is in applications engineering, manufacturing, installing, and safety norms. And very important, because lots and lots of knowledge will be generated, lots of innovations will come about, a lot of things will happen. Immediately, you have to sign with the industry, and we have signed with the industry a joint IP. The university will also be a co-owner of the intellectual property with the industry. And there will be a benefit sharing arrangement between the industry and the university when these things get commercialized by the industry. So important point is that the moment you conceptualize the problem, you're also bringing together into it all the other elements that will make this possibly a success. You don't think about these things later. You have to think all this and conceptualize right in the beginning. That's the difference between a visionary thinking and a mere thinking. We have to have visionary thinking because you have to see beyond the horizon, right? Now, at what stage the industry has joined right in the beginning? That means when the university started talking about it, the industry joined right in the beginning. So the point is, right from the word go and the word start, the industry is with you. Because please understand, in most of the educational institutions, including IITs, etc., where I teach, see, we do not develop technologies. We develop concepts. We develop we develop applications. We develop various things. But the real we scaled up. It has to be made to work. It has to be done. All that industry understands. Most of the engineering institutions don't understand that much. So you need the industry to really bring both. Right. How was the industry identified? Because Willo is already well known for doing all these sewage things. So the university and the industry can come together. And in Vishwakarma University, right from the beginning, from the word go, we have put down how, you know, these type of innovations, whenever we talk about designing various things, how will we do? We will look for industry, we'll look for those. So all this is a part of the culture now. So it's the innovation culture that we have introduced in the industry, in the university, as a matter of policy. Now let's go to the next slide. Next slide. In the next slide, yeah. So now, you know, so these have done. So where is this project? Proof of principle has been done. Technology concept, analytical and functional, critical functional characteristic, proof of concept has been established. Design and sizing of components and subsystems have also been established. Obviously, industry is a part of all this process. It's not being done only one way. It's always a two-way process. Prototype is being manufactured and installed in the university campus for functional testing. So you can see, just in a matter of very short time, because of the involvement of industry, how fast the project moves towards this particular. And what is the already we see in the design, reduction in footprint is about 60% of a horizontal plant. Fantastic. And only after testing we will know. The expectation is about 25% reduction in energy consumption. If this happens, it's a fantastic innovation, right? What is the impact of this? Let's go to the next slide. So here, with this, you can install this, you know, in cluster of buildings to treat sewage from building clusters as a decentralized system. So your pressure, your load on the local municipal facilities will get reduced. So the municipal facilities can be used to service more areas in the locality. Lower energy usage will lead to cost saving. Building clusters can reuse the treated water for their own purposes out there. So it will optimize the water usage. Next stage of the innovation would be to make this water portable, which has not yet happened. It will happen at some stage. As the industry is participating from the beginning, the technology taker is an integral part, and hence the probability of the technology being commercialized is enhanced. And students, faculty are getting hands-on experience to deal with real-life problems as part of their academic upbringing. That's the social impact out there, that you're creating a completely new generation of technocrats, technology and technocrats out there. Very important. And that is what our university education must bring up. And we should be able to have more such examples and get, you know, these type of things. Let's go to the next slide. Now I come to a very interesting case study number 5. You know, all of us eat these Lay's chips. Now, next time you eat a Lay's chip, just open it and look at the Lay's chip, right? Can anybody tell me what is the characteristic of the Lay's chip? Can anybody tell me? When you look at the Lay's chip, can you tell me, anybody? Anybody just tell, what does the Lay's chip look like? Or what do you feel about it? Forget about it.
Corrugated.
Good. That's number one. What else? Corrugated is number one, is absolutely correct. What else?
Person can come unmute and then also share their views on the question.
Same shape and size. Very good. Correct. Somebody has put same. Yes. What else? So uniformity. What else? Very important. What else? Crispy. Yes, you're absolutely correct. Crispy. What else?
Size of chips are a bit longer as compared to other.
You're right. What else? What else? Something very typical and only in that list chip.
Size is uniform.
Yes, that's right. What else? Something very unique. A
beautiful zigzag shape.
And the corrugated.
Yes, corrugated. But what else? What else? Something very, very unique. There is no chip in the world which is like that. Addictive, of course, it is addictive because you eat. What else? Okay, I will tell you what else. Anybody else? Taste every time. Yes, you are right. Same taste. Very uniformity of taste. Very correct. Absolutely. Taste remains the same. Very good. What else? Something else.
Absolutely tightly packed.
That is also correct, but what else? Something which is very unique.
The color is not changed. It is uniform.
It is, you know, this beautiful thing is the color of the Lay's chip is uniform. There is no brown spot. There is no brown spot. Very interesting. Because the moment you see brown spot, you say, kharab ho gaya. Isn't it?
Yes.
Lay's had to make, apart from everything that all of you have said, uniformity, the corrugated, the, you know, size, the shape, then, you know, the same taste. But the interesting part is the whole thing is of one color only. There is no multiple color, no brown spots, black spots in the chip. So next time you open a chip packet, you have a look at it. And if you see a brown or spot, then immediately send it back to Lay's and tell them that, look, this is not okay. Right? Now let's go to the next slide with this background. Interesting. There's a lot of science behind all this. Here you can see that consumers of potato chips tend to associate color with flavors, safety, storage time, nutrition, and level of satisfaction. You know why the color changes during frying? because acrylamide gets formed during frying and is related to color of chips, which depends on the content of reducing sugars, amino acids or proteins at the surface. The color is also affected by frying temperature and time. The surface color reflects not only heterogeneous surface formed as a result of frying, but also of the non-homogeneous oil distribution. And it is known that 2.5 to 3 milligrams of reducing sugars per gram of potato should be the maximum value accepted for potato chip preparation. So what Pepsi did to solve the problem, they made designer potatoes. They developed new potato variety. So Pepsi developed potato tubers with tailored specification of the sugar content and protected them as registered new plant variety. And then organized contract farming in various parts of the world, including India, to ensure uniformity of their potatoes used for preparation of chips. Interesting. So nip it at the bud, if you think. So therefore, if you see here, what did they do? They created potato tubers of desired quality in terms of moisture and sugar content. Estimate the amount of acrylamide that can get formed during frying of this. Select the potato of a given size and shape range. Use appropriate technology for processing of potato in terms of peeling, slicing, cutting to different shapes. So all these are technologies. Eh? Fry the potato slices using technology and equipment, minimum oil, avoid browning, disfiguring of chips produced, and retaining crispiness and flavor. Design consumer-friendly packaging for maximized shelf life and transportation. Identify the intellectual property generated at every stage of the value chain with appropriate strategy for IP protection and enforcement, and strategize approaches to brand building and reaching out to customers. So you can see that how they have looked at the value chain fully. So let's go to the next slide. So what did they do? So what did they do? They developed a comprehensive public-private contract farming supply chain. I've actually visited these places in Bartaman. They are quality driven, involve small landlords, farmers, and network of agronomists, and partnerships with public and private service providers who purchase potatoes specially developed for processing into chips. So these are very special potatoes. Now, what do they do? The farmers have to purchase the branded FL2027 potato tubers called FC5 under a contract agreement in which the resulting produce is purchased from PepsiCo at a predetermined price. Then what does PepsiCo do to the farmers? They give them technical support. You know, they have agronomists who go and advise the farmers how to procure, you know, which agrochemicals are required, what should be the mode of farming, how to use the water, etc., etc. So they get the uniformity there. They get the standard. And it is to be noted that the FC5 potato variety has been registered in India by PepsiCo under the Plant Varieties and Farmers' Rights Act 2001. Important. So they have to comprehensively look at this particular innovation. Go further to the next slide. Look at all those intellectual property. Patents. For everything, they've got patents. Design registration on the shapes of those. Trademark. They've got artwork, copyright artwork, plant variety protection, trade secrets. So you can see how the company looks at their intellectual property in a holistic manner. So they manage the intellectual property. Let's go next slide. So what is the social impact? First, consumers get consistent quality product. Contract farming of the special product tubers has given opportunity to small farmers to engage in predictable farming with ensured earnings. Farming practices have got upgraded in local farms due to technical inputs from agronomists hired by the company to ensure the farmers follow the recommended agro processing practices. If they don't do that, they won't get the uniform potatoes. So how much water to put, how to put, or which agro chemical, how to put the fertilizer, how to do, everything is to a process. Sustainable job opportunities have opened up all stakeholders in the entire farm to market value chain, and collaborative and cooperative company businesses in value chain with NGOs, SMEs, entrepreneurs, and small farmers. And of course, contract farming has not become, well, it, well, you know, contract farming can only become popular. You know, there was a question which was asked by somebody. Contract farming can become popular only if it is managed properly. It has to be managed extremely. The management process of contract farming is very complex. I mean, I was myself involved in something many years ago. It's extremely complex. How to manage all these things in the entire supply chain. You have to really, really have some of the finest management techniques in doing that. So the question is well taken. It is not popular here in India because it's very difficult to discipline everybody. See, if I tell everybody you have to put one bucket of water, somebody will put 1.5 or somebody will put half. But 1.5 is 1.5. But one bucket is one. Germans are very good at that. The Japanese are very good at that. The Chinese are very good at that. The Koreans are very good at it. We aren't. So let's go. Now, these are the five case studies that I thought I would present. Now, what I want to do in the next half an hour that we have, I want to go to what is the learning out of this and how do we create a theoretical framework in which we can work. And of course, put many examples, but then first of all, I have said value chain is a relay process. Correct? It is not run by one person. There are a whole bunch of people. And like when we run a relay race, it's very important out there. So the first part is that it has to be a transformation approach across the whole innovation value chain to be adopted if we have to realistically and sustainably impact societal causes. So I've seen in all the examples that we have taken, we have looked at the whole innovation value chain and not only a small part. That's a very important part. Second, innovation value chain involves what? Identifying and zeroing in on an issue. So like in case of Praful Naik, they first zeroed in on saying, can we create those blocks? Well, why they wanted the blocks? Because they had a much bigger plan in mind. But we want to do something like that and something like that. The first part is the block. So identifying and zeroing in on an issue. If you look at each of the cases and then zeroed in on an issue, then initiating an exploration, how do you explore the various options, various possibilities? Then very important, because you're going to do it, you know, on the ground, you have to understand, you have to explore and also check whether there are cultural beliefs and practices. For example, if you want to put a device in a tube well, then, you know, there may be something, are a tube well mein dal diya to kya hoga? You know, somebody may come and say, are wo kuch dal diya to bhool nikla. You know, anything can happen. So you have to understand cultural beliefs and practices. How to do things, what to do. Thinking about production and associated issues, you have to think about that. You can't say, I'll first produce it, I will first develop it, then production could go, you know, we can think later. You have to think about it today. Because the success or failure of a project will depend whether it can be scaled up. You can make one piece, you can make two pieces, but can you make a few million pieces? Now, if you've made those pieces, how do you plan for distribution, marketing, or trading? So that, why? To reach the person for whom the innovation is meant. Now, in each of the examples I gave you, I showed you how holistically, at each point, every aspect was thought through, and each aspect was taken through all this. Let's go to the next slide. Now, this is a very important part. Deciding on one's involvement and delivery in an identified portion of the value chain. So I can't do everything. I know what I'm good at. I know what I'm doing. So I do that part. And then I have the foresight and clarity of how to involve others and how to partner. So, you know, how innovation deliverables will get carried forward in the value chain. So I don't have to do everything, and therefore a value chain is a relay process, but every member in the relay team plays a vital role in achieving the set goal. Any weak link or links in the relay process will de-accelerate the progress and can result in non-achievement of set goals or even culminate in deviation from the set goals. So whether it's contract manufacturing, whether it's Amul, whether it is university industry interaction, whether it is like Praful's overall thing on housing, or it is Anjan's thing on creating this particular device, You must know what you are good at, what you will do, but you must also know what are the various links in this particular value chain and how will the relay process go. Because if the relay process breaks, then it will be non-achievement of the set goal. So you have to think through this whole stuff, and only then it will be a success, not otherwise. Otherwise, you know, you'll say something, oh, I'll be, now my part I've done, but then what happens? The overall project is not made. This is something that we need to have holistic thinking. Let's go to the next slide. To the next slide. Yeah. Now, that is where the tactical partnerships, collaborations, exploiting interdisciplinary knowledge and experience. That was the example of, you know, both in case of Pepsi, in case of Amul, in case of Praful's part, going to AIT, in case of Anjan, going to various other people, you know, out there. Then transacting intellectual property rights, we talked about it already in all the examples. Transferring the relay baton selectively to an appropriate party on time are strategic decisions necessary to necessary at crucial points in the value chain to ensure successful completion of said goal. Very important. So, you know, it's like creating a master plan. When you do an innovation, unless you have a master plan and put down everything, it's a war. You know, it's like war against COVID. He's not just doing one little thing or one little that. You cannot say, I'll just only have lockdown, but with lockdown, you need many other things. So you need the whole relay process. Then mapping of logistics, you know, human resource. Now, for example, in proposed case, you know, the appropriate skills. Now, if very high skills to build, then you will have to bring in labor from outside. So this requires less amount of skill. So therefore, the innovation lies in designing those blocks so that you can self-align, you don't need mortar, you don't need this. So with low skill, you can do it. That does not mean it is low quality. It is high quality, that's where high technology is required to make things of this type. Then procurement of raw materials, they're going to make it from mud, very simple. Transportation of finished goods, you know, et cetera, et cetera. All these are very important issues for designing of scale-up and sustainability. Again, why? To reach the person from whom the innovation is meant. So that going to the last mile is where the difference between success and failure. Let's go to the next part, and that is here. Societal engagement, very important. Cultural compatibility, we talked about all this. Forcing possible regulatory issues, very important. Now, for example, in Amul, you know, you made these cooperatives. Now, there may be regulatory issues. There may be other issues. You put milk, you pool milk together. What about the quality issues and regulatory issues? All very important. How do you store all those conditions? In the innovation value chains may be necessary for absorption, diffusion, and acceptance of end products of innovation for societal change. Now, if you make things and you don't take these into consideration, then people will reject your innovation. And you say, I've done a great thing, but nobody has taken it. Very important. Yes, I must give you an example, a very interesting example. Way back in 1971-72, I used to during my PhD, I was doing a lot of work in Madhya Pradesh, in the villages. And, you know, many of us, it was a big program. And many of us used to, go and teach there. We had designed certain training programs for village teachers, and we used to go and teach in Hindi science out there to village. So we designed some very, you know, as city dwellers, you know, I used to do my PhD in TI for Department of Fundamental Research. So, you know, we have that background. Now, with all that, we have designed some experiments to show how life is, you know, how life comes into existence. So we took some eggs, you know, which were fertilized eggs, which is 1 day old, 3 days old, 8, 7 days old, 10 days old. You know, and we would break the egg, put it on a petri dish to show how the chick is developing. And one of the village teachers asked me a very beautiful question, which I haven't forgotten. This question was asked to me in 1971. And I'm repeating that today in 2020, right? And the question he asked me, he said, sir, you know, he asked me in Hindi, jeev ke liye, that is to understand life, do you have to kill life? Can you not show this in any other way without killing life? To show me how this, you kill 10 eggs, so 10 chicks are gone. Would you be doing it that way? Cultural acceptability, and cultural engagement. A complete life change after that. The whole thinking process of this. Then conceptualization of innovation value chain also involves provision of backup plans. But you may fail. But then what are your backup plans? What are the mid-course correction gates? What are the options for timely exit with possible transmission of knowledge to other entities or individuals to carry forward? I may not have completed it, but can others not do it? So I have to think about all these things, and hence the title of that particular of the talk today, that the title of the talk which I have given, which I have created today, is basically what it is. Let's go to the last two slides. Next slide. And I just want to throw some ideas. See, we have so much of forest produce. Most of it is not properly channelized, and most of this forest produce, whatever is done, because they are collected in a very disorganized manner or unorganized manner, whatever we process, have very low shelf life, therefore we don't have great marketability. And among many, many billions of examples in this country, I just picked up kokum as an example. Kokum is a little fruit which is a forest produce in the Konkan region. You know, if you go to the western side of India, to the from in Maharashtra, the Gowan, Konkan, that region, you know, you get a lot of kokum. So interestingly, the shelf life is very low, you know, and all these are there, and therefore, because of this, you are not able to market these particular things. You can't sell. Now imagine you make some innovations related to this, the entire logistics will change. The entire socioeconomic structures will change. The entire social impact will be phenomenal. Now, this is something which is extremely important. We should think about it. Then I keep going a lot. I've been tracking a lot in this week of late. And there are lots and lots of absolutely phenomenal suites, which are very characteristics of certain districts and certain areas of West Bengal. And that is exactly the case also across the country. And there is some very extraordinary products called Joynagar Moa, Mihidana, Sitabog, all the, you know, Joynagar Moa comes from a place called Joynagar, Mihidana and Sitabog comes from a place called Bhartokal. I visited all these. And what is the shelf life? 24 hours to 36 hours. Obviously, they can't sell it beyond the region, small place. They can't even sell that in Calcutta. So by the time they bring it to Calcutta, it's gone. All these are protected as geographical indications in India. So imagine if in our universities and institutions and in these type of centers that we are going to run, in case of our innovation systems or other innovation mission. You imagine you make that 36 hours into 5 days and see the impact, the entire socioeconomic impact. You will have transformed lives of thousands of people in those places. Very important. Let's go to the last slide for today. And I have done a lot of work in the Northeast with the Muga silk people in Assam. Now, you know, the quality of the silk depends on the cocoons, and then it's processed in a certain way. And all this is very seasonal. Therefore, weaving is a seasonal activity. Now, imagine if you can do innovations there, and if the 4 or 5 months that they work on this, if they can make it into 7 months or 10 months, the entire socioeconomic structure of that place changes. You know, the entire thing changes. Now we need to think more, you know, we have to look around us and think hard how to think about these type of issues and not think about artificial issues. So these are the type of things I thought. And I said, imagine the socioeconomic impact of innovations in fields with transformational business and lives of people. And therefore, I come to the end of the formal part of the presentation, and I repeat, Atal Bihari Vajpayee's statement that I dream of an India that is prosperous, strong, and caring, an India that regains a place of honor in the committee of great nations. Now, the only way we can do these particular things is by really thinking in these terms and taking things up further, right? Now, if there are any questions and other things, let us take up some questions if there are any, and we can have even cross discussions, because we have Praful Naik with us, we have Siddharth Jalbe's team from Vishwakarma, we have also Anjan Mukherjee, at least three of the of them are there, and other questions you can raise and we can take it out. Please raise your questions, if any.
Good evening, sir. This was wonderful.
Thank you, sir. Just a minute. Thank you, sir. I would like to request also, if you need, you can have a glass of water, because I was feeling that you need the glass of water. And team, you can write the questions in the chat box, and gradually, if you want to come live, you can also raise your hand so that I can unmute your microphone from here. So, anybody who would like to come live, they can just raise the hand. There is a raise hand option in your options field. Sir, Nishit, sir.
Ganguly, it was a very nice presentation.
Right. Question which has been asked is whether Praful Naik and Anjan could share some of your experiences being a part of the innovation. So, Praful, can you share? And also Anjan, maybe a few sentences.
Praful here, pleasure to be with you, Atal Mission team. Thanks, Dr. Ganguly and Dr. Pandit for incorporating us into this dialogue with Dr. Prabuddha Ganguly. In fact, I have been associated with Dr. Ganguly for quite some time now, and we have been having a very clear, likewise, ground in terms of innovation. So my background is pharmaceutical engineering, but I have been fortunate to have been a team of innovators in very diverse areas, and especially when this innovation was happening with respect to the social housing cluster or building structures integrated with sanitation system, our approach was to look at how can we make the technology with a reverse paradigm, which is being people centric. Normally, the concept of technology makes the thinking process that it will eliminate people. We wanted to have people incorporated, so it's a people extensively people oriented technology which we created, where people lot of people have to work. So 60% of the outcomes, financial outcomes, goes into the people aspect. So that's how we created it, and that's where we thought it is creating a value, especially in the rural regions. That was what
Anjan,
I wanted.
Would you like to add something from your side, Anjan? Okay. I think we have lost Anjan. But anyway.
Can you hear me?
Anybody from Vishwakarma would like to raise any?
Mr. Anjan is live now. Anjanji, you can share. Yeah, we can hear you. You can share your experience and journey briefly.
I just wanted to share one very small incident regarding, firstly, it's a huge challenge to go to a village and convince the sarpanch that we need to fit it in your village. Because the first question he asks is, how do I know that it's not harmful? And for that, we obviously need the government help. In our case, the NGO said that no, it is not harmful. Then we thought of a very unique idea that we fitted the first piece, which we actually got as a donation from one of our well-wishers, next to the sarpanch's house. Now, what it did was, firstly, the sarpanch was very happy that, his house has been, he can just walk and get the safe water, which otherwise he had to, it was a suspect water. But soon the whole village realized that this water is perceptibly better. So there used to be a huge queue in front of his house, which the sarpanch didn't like one bit. So just to remove that queue, he bought for the entire village. And this is a true incident. So you have to think slightly creatively in what you have to do.
Anybody Hello. Else? Any?
Yeah, Anjanji, we heard you. I would also like to mention here, Anjanji, and just entire ACIC. Yeah, entire ACIC team to know that we have presented 4 cutting edge technology to when our Prime Minister visited Israel. So Anjanji's solution is among these 4 technology out of 250 different technology which we have evaluated. And there was a 14 different round of evaluation wherein his technology could able to survive, and then final 4 which were demonstrated in Israel and which was viewed by Israeli Prime Minister Sri Netanyahu ji and our Prime Minister Narendra Modi ji. So Anjanji's solution is among those 4. Now, sir, I think Professor Nishit Desai sir also wanted to share something or would like to ask. So I will request Nishit sir to come live.
Good evening, Dr. Ganguly. After a long time, we are meeting, no?
Namaskar, namaskar.
One minute, sir. Sir, Ganguly, sir, you can enable your camera. And Nishit, sir, you can tilt your laptop screen so that we can see you. Yes. Okay.
So, Dr. Ganguly, after sir, a very long time, we are meeting.
Just, Nishit, sir, just 1 minute. Sir, I would like to mention here that we have begun this brainstorming on intellectual property rights with the lecture from Nishit sir immediately next day to the World IP Day. And then now today we have invited you with a detailed elaboration. So he has also nicely explained about the intellectual property, its history, and the various tools of the IP, and specifically in-depth understanding about the patent aspect. And then we have a design thinking aspect and innovation aspect for the academic institution, and then community innovation and the IP. And then now today we have example on the various example for the value-added chain. So this is the complete series which we have taken up from last Monday to this Wednesday. So now over to Nishit sir.
Good afternoon. Good evening, Professor Ganguly.
Good evening. Boliye.
After a long time, we are meeting. We met last time in 3rd of August at Babnagar, no?
Correct. When I came to lecture. Go ahead.
Yeah. Now, I am very much interested for this, bacteria-free technology. This is commercially available right now because we are interested to install in our departments. If it is commercially available in Babnagar, we had a lot available. Of...
It is commercially available. It's commercially available. London,
and what will be the problem cost? What is the probable cost of
that? We will send Anjan. Anjan will send it across to you. Nishit bhai, you give ID and I will connect you with Anjan.
Yeah, fine. I'll give Unnat knows my email ID.
Yeah. Sir, I will share the contact details of Nishit sir with Anjan ji, and we'll connect both of them.
Yeah. Saurashtra is facing, the entire state, entire Saurashtra is facing, a quality of the water, no? probably, you know, Sauras will be the, you know, very good stakeholder for this technology.
Wonderful.
Thank you very much.
Wonderful.
So, any questions further? Though we have exceeded today by a few minutes, but it was wonderful and interactive. And sir, your insightful experience and the explaining the various tools and the with example entire value chain, how we can translate the innovation and how we can serve the community and the academic institution, taking up the innovation and commercializing this with the licensing aspect, protecting one particular invention in the various other modes of IP tool, utilizing them. This was a wonderful experience for all the ACIC institution. And I'm sure that would be much more encouraging and enlightening to all the institutions. So, sir, we have one more formality, which we can say that we take the selfie with all our guests who are coming. So this is a digital selfie. So everybody is then posting through their social media forum. So would request all the team members to enable their camera, come closer the camera, and then I will take the selfie and will share it with you so that everybody can make it in a social media, and that's a huge attraction. So one of the lecture also got published in a few daily newspaper. So that's something, the kind of attraction which is happening. And they have also
social media. Also is a value chain.
Yes, sir. Yeah, absolutely. So Anjanji, would also request you to enable your camera if possible, so we can capture you as well.
How do you do that?
So there is one icon just beside the microphone. There is one camera icon which you have to press, and by that way people can see you.
We are unable to do that today, actually.
Not unable. We are not able to do it.
Yeah. We are not able to do it, sir, today. I think it has been blocked by your side or?
No, it's not logged. It's accessible. Let's try after some time as well. So first selfie I have taken. We have a huge audience. I can only capture 25 people in one screen. So I will request few people who's selfie I have already taken, they can leave. Biplab ji, I have already taken. Deepak ji, I have taken. Dr. B. Venkatraman ji, Gyan ji, Dr. Ji, Lanin ji, I have already taken. Rajesh ji, Ruchi ji, I have already taken, captured. Sashi Dhar ji, Mr. Nangi ji, I have already taken. Vikas ji, I have already taken. So now a few other people, request them also to enable their camera. Charumati ji, you can enable their center ji. You can enable Siddharth ji. You can enable Ankita. You can also enable Ankit. You can also enable Sushil ji. You can enable your camera. Anna, you can enable your camera. So I can capture your selfie. Yes. Senthil Kumar ji, you can enable your camera. I am unable to see you. Arvind Bisa ji, you can enable. Maybe few people are experiencing some problem.
Sir, we are experiencing some problems.
I'm actually experiencing the problem in enabling my
okay.
Issue. I'm unable to.
Your name will be appearing in this selfie. I have captured Vikas ji, Srinivas ji, Shashwat Pathak ji. I have already captured Sashidhar ji. I have already captured your Biplab ji, I have already captured your screen in the camera. Gyan ji, I have already captured. Dr. Amol, I have already captured you.
It's tremendous.
And final round of selfie.
Very nice. Very nice. And you can share the presentation with everybody.
Sure, sir. Sure.
Question you can share.
Right after this, we'll be sharing this presentation. Thank you very much. Thank you, sir, for joining and sharing your insightful view. I will also request Nishit.
Thank you. I must thank you. I must thank Praful. I must thank Anjan. I must thank Siddharth and everybody who has contributed their case studies to me, which I could very quickly put together. So each one of them sent me 25, 30 slides, 40 slides. So I had to pick up and make the 3 or 4, you know, comprehensively for the purpose of this. So a big thank you to every one of them, because they all sent it within hours of my respect. I mean, request. Just within few hours of my request, all of them sent it. So that it made it possible to make this presentation.
Definitely. Thank you. Siddharji, Prakashji, and Anjanji for joining this session, and special thanks to Professor Nishit Desai sir also for joining this session. And it's a complete cycle which we have completed today, starting from Nishit sir's lecture and this Wednesday your lecture, and we had again a series of 3 other additional lectures. So complete 5 lectures in this row has really enlightened the entire IP awareness initiative for all the ACIC institution, and definitely this is going to transform the community innovation space in tier 2, tier 3 cities. Once again, with this thanks, I would again appreciate the participants also who have joined and who have really shared their questions and the experience shared by Anjanji and all entire team. Thank you very much.
Good. Only what you can do is tell everybody if they have any question can send you, and then we can share the answers across the thing to everybody.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.